My name's James Herman, and we're in the Laboratory for Sensory Motor Research, which is a subdivision of the National Eye Institute at the National Institutes of Health in Bethesda, Maryland. We study the brain. We try to understand how large groups of brain cells function, which brain cells contribute to which functions that an animal does. Both of my parents were English professors. My father always used to say, "A life of the mind is what it's all about." I'm named James after James Joyce. So, you know, just some small shoes to fill there, nothing crazy. When I was young, I was extraordinarily curious all the time. I've loved trying to sort of understand the world around me and explain everything that I see from a very young age. In the first grade, when my formal mathematics education began, I was hooked instantaneously on math. I loved it. I was looking at the back of one of these marble notebooks that everyone has as a first grader. Probably the first, you know, epiphany that I ever had as a young man was realizing that this was the times table that was printed on the back of this marble notebook. This, you know, grid of mysterious numbers turned out to have some meaning and reason behind it. And so for me, science is really an extension of that. I record from one brain cell at a time, but the brain has between 10 and 100 billion cells in it. So recording from one at a time is a very, very slow way to work things out. I need to carefully measure and calibrate all of the equipment that I use every day. So that involves, you know, inspecting these electrodes that I'm going to use to record the brain activity. And they're really, really small. Ooh, that one is no good. So I'm looking at a microelectrode. It's a small piece of tungsten wire, and it's coated in epoxy. And right at the tip, I need to make sure that I have a perfect little point. But it looks like this one, I do not. So I'm going to have to get rid of it and look for another one. Mm. 3.0 megaohm. Excellent. And then I have a whole bunch of other equipment that I need to measure and align and just carefully set up before any of this can go on. I sit in front of a bank of, you know, maybe 10 computer screens where I'm carefully trying to monitor everything from the animal's behavior to how much juice they're getting to the position of my electrode and what the electrical activity that's coming off of there is, where the animal is looking. That is the sound of brain activity in response to color stimulus. One way of looking at the brain is as a computational device, as something that does mathematical operations. And we know that the way that it performs those mathematical operations is not the way that we would expect, which is very strange because here's this thing that's sitting in our head. It's our brain. It would be really great if we could sort of break away from the structure we have, the understanding we have about how those operations should be done, so that we can start to make progress on understanding how this really, you know, in some ways alien object performs all these things. I'm incredibly lucky. I get to use my curiosity. I get to follow up on everything that I'm curious about. There you go.
Injection dips.
Oh, that's a good idea. You know, I love the fact that I can hang out with my colleagues every day and we can, you know, we can bounce ideas off of each other and we can talk about, you know, oh, I see this way, and no, well, you know, I see it sort of more like this, because, you know, that you the benefit gained from other people's opinions and other people's viewpoints is just completely invaluable.
So you look at the combination too?
I mean, so there's a change in the amount of deficit, This is all, I think, new territory. I don't think that's expected. I think that's unexpected for, so you might have, you know, a group of people all hanging out, talking, and, you know, sort of like agreeing, and then you realize that no one has understood anything. So, you know, it's incredibly important to just ask as many questions as you possibly can. I think that there is, for some people, the feeling that they're not smart enough or that they're not good enough to do a certain level of work or something, you know, that they feel, oh, I could never do that. I could never, you know, be a mathematician. I could never be this. I could never be that. It, you know, it's not about being the best. It's not about being, you know, the smartest. Your viewpoint is unique. You are the only one who has it. No one can take it away from you, and it has incredible value. So hold on to it, be proud of it, make use of it.